Hello and welcome to the latest instalment of AWS for Data. I'm Paddy Fitzpatrick. I lead the AWS for software companies business in the UK and Ireland. And really pleased to be joined today by the folks at Tray.io, a real success story for the UK software industry. And I'm joined here today by Rich, who's the CEO, and Alin, the Senior Engineering Manager. Rich, just for those viewers who are maybe not aware of what Tray.io does, could you just tell me what business problems you look to solve?
Sure, and thanks for having us today, Paddy. The business problem that we solve at Tray is unlocking all of that trapped data that lives in the silos across organizations that massively slows down processes and ultimately leads to poor performance within our organizations. Our customers use the Tray Universal Automation Cloud to automate and integrate all of these different services together. So that can manifest itself in things like quote-to-cash integration for a finance team, or a lead lifecycle process for a marketing team, all the way through to data ingestion or anomaly detection and sharing from a data team perspective. So we really work kind of across an organization to help unlock all the data that's trapped within those silos.
Okay, thank you. And how would you summarize Tray.io's journey with the iPaaS space? Maybe tell us what iPaaS is, and over the years, and have you leveraged AWS to support your strategic growth?
Yeah, I mean, it's been a thrilling journey. And I think as we've seen the waves of technology evolve over the last 30 years, each shift creates a whole new opportunity for iPaaS. So customers that are looking to buy an iPaaS itself, you know, that's really the place that you go and do all of your integration. That's where you're connecting to all of the different tools you have, the databases, the services, and typically that's done via either code or a low-code type interface. Mm-hmm. And so the journey that we've been on is, you know, we launched Tray really as cloud computing was exploding, and it changed the paradigm for how people would look to integrate and connect these services together, because suddenly everything being hosted in the cloud create a whole new wave of challenges for organizations that were going through digital transformation. This last few years has been really thrilling because as the sort of evolution of AI has unfolded in front of us, that's created a whole new set of challenges for companies that not only have to figure out this automation and integration headache, but how do we go and infuse or take advantage of AI within our automation strategy? And so for Tray, we've really put ourselves at the forefront of that movement. We're really pushing iPaaS into a whole new place by harnessing AI through the platform itself.
Excellent. Alin, anything to add?
The way we leverage AWS in our stack is by leveraging a lot of tools across the stack that complement each other and help us deliver great experiences for our customer. We've invested in building foundational data systems that allow us to scale in line with the business demand and the customer growth, and ensuring that we are have the best enterprise tooling available for our customers' needs.
Ah, excellent, thank you. So let's move on to talk about data strategy. Rich, how do you align the company's business goals in tandem with data strategy and insights?
Yeah, I think rather than thinking about them as an alignment exercise, really for us, data strategy is a key driver in making decisions. And at every point, if you think about the breadth of data that we have available as an organization, we get a sense of what are the latest trends that our customers are engaging in? What are some of the problems that they're trying to solve within their organizations? What are some of the titles of the folks that are starting to tackle automation and integration for the first time? And the big change that Tray brought to the world was enabling this automation and integration challenge to be solved by a much broader audience. So we now see people in marketing ops teams, sales ops teams, finance ops teams, being able to do things that they previously couldn't. And so where data kind of plays a role for us is we're constantly looking and trying to refine, how do we deliver the right marketing message to these different audiences? What's important to them as we kind of go through that journey? A kind of great sort of near-term example I can give is we analyzed the usage across all of our different customer segments. And then that helped reshape how we distributed some of our marketing spend into those segments themselves, because we got a better sense of, okay, well, you know, we have a better fit within this type of organization, within this type of team, so let's tighten the message, let's improve the enablement for that area, and then you start to see, you know, really impressive growth off the back of a much tighter and much cleaner strategy.
Yeah, it's interesting you're saying about the new roles evolving. We're starting to see now a chief AI officer as a role coming in. We wouldn't have seen that quite a while ago, and we'll come onto AI a little bit later. So how's your journey with data evolved over the years, and what were the customer signals that prompted you to come up with Merlin?
Merlin, for the audience that isn't aware, is the AI that's infused throughout our entire platform. And so for us, that isn't just a natural language or generative AI approach that we've taken within the product. That obviously is a component of it. But it's that we're harnessing AI through every facet of the platform. And as Alin will touch on shortly, one of the key things that we do is we provide data insights back to our customers. So being able to infuse that with AI itself, again, is something that is proven really gainful for us. How we came up with that sort of idea, or where that signal came from, actually goes back to the genesis of building the company in the first place. When we started building the platform, it was because we wanted to harness the power of APIs and computing in a way that didn't require somebody to write a full application, deploy it, load balance it, test it, and manage it on an ongoing basis. We abstract that away from the customer. So we provide this low-code method that allows you to go and do that. So if you think from day one, what we've really been trying to do is democratize programming. We've been trying to make it easier for people to create really robust solutions and take the sort of the components that you need to build a powerful application and break it down into something that's easy to maintain, easy to manage, easy to govern, but most importantly is secure. And so really for us, it's such a natural fit starting to drive Merlin, because it continues to lower that barrier of entry. It continues to make it easier for people to do things that they previously couldn't. And so the signals that drove us to that really sort of aligned to what I was just saying in terms of looking at how customers engage with the platform. You know, where do we see opportunities for a better experience, or where is there maybe a roughness in how somebody's trying to complete maybe a data manipulation within a workflow itself? You know, as we then played around with the concepts that GenAI brought, it opened up a whole new way for us to be able to serve the customer. And so, you know, those signals are not just data driven, but they're also really the sort of driving instinct of why we brought trade to the world in the first place.
And I know that you've had some recognition of this recently.
We have, yeah. We're delighted to announce this week that we've been recognized in the visionary quadrant in Gartner's MQ that was launched yesterday. And for us, you know, that is not only a proud moment for our company and on behalf of our customers, but really an indication that, you know, we're really looking down the road for where iPaaS goes. And I think that to me is the most critical part of this. iPaaS evolves through every single generation and through every software shift. And it's clear that we're, you know, right in the midst of a major change for everybody.
Yeah, and for us, who've been working with you for years, it's nice to see that broader recognition of the visionary nature of the organization and technology that you have.
Thank you.
Okay, so let me move on to Alin. I've got a question for you. As a universal automation platform, Trey has unique data insights that can benefit your customers' performance. So how do you think about using this as a differentiator, especially on the GenAI side of things?
Sure. So as Rich was mentioning, customers use Trey to power a lot of their business critical processes internally by building integrations and automation on our platform. A lot of the times they build these integrations and automations on behalf of their own customers to provide them as a solution to them as the end user. And we use our data systems and our data platform to inform all of those business processes, provide insights at every level, be it in real time or aggregations and things that require further enrichment with various data points that are generated throughout the platform. On top of this, GenAI can help analyze workflow data It can dynamically adapt workflows based on AI recommendations, as well as create ultimately helping them create customized automation paths in their organization. Tray platform can also automate routine decision. This can assist in decision making. Real-time insights can enable faster response and better customer experiences. It can predict potential bottlenecks in your organization or in your business processes, and highlight failures and resource shortages. So overall, we believe that insights is going to provide a holistic improvement of the experience and help make the automations more performant and efficient.
Wow, there's a lot to unpack in there. And if I, you've obviously had to make a lot of technology decisions over the years. So just tell me a little bit more about your technology landscape and the sort of decisions you've made on technology.
Sure, we've built a comprehensive data platform on AWS. To give you some example, we use Kafka MSK for stream processing. We use Redshift for our data warehousing. We use Spark and EMR for batch processing, as well as Airflow for data orchestration. And we're experimenting with Flink for real-time stream processing to get that extra bit of insights. We are addressing distinct needs with these technologies. We're looking at purpose-driven functionality. These are powerful systems. They are versatile, managed, highly available, fault-tolerant. Scalability is obviously very important. So we want systems that scale horizontally in line with the business demand and with the growth of our company, but also our customers' implementations and applications. We are looking to handle a large amounts of data, volumes, and try to maintain performance while doing that. Security is obviously a very important consideration. We're looking at encryption. We're looking at proper IAM roles and security access controls.
Thanks, Alin. That's really insightful. I think you use over 30 AWS services in your stack, so it's great to see such an advanced use of the stack that we have. So Rich, if I'll come to you, we talked about data insights and the data insights you provide to your customers. I think ultimately that they can provide to theirs. So how do you make sure in development enhancement of products that data insights are built in?
Yeah, I mean, it's a critical part of the process. And for me and for us as a company, data is a really important guide. It shouldn't be the complete decision maker. It doesn't give you the full picture, but it does give you the direction and it does help you find the path to ultimately build a better solution for your customer. So for our product team, part of their process is looking at how is that functionality currently being consumed? What does the usage look like? Are there obvious blockers in the way that the product itself is actually being utilized by that end customer? And so a good example of that, the way that our workflows are structured, historically that would be they'd be split up and run individually. We switched over to a project-based model that would allow you to keep all of the assets in one place. And we instantly saw more deployment, faster deployment, and quicker time to promotion for our organizations because of that subtle product shift.
Excellent. And what sort of feedback have you had from your customers about that?
I mean, the feedback on that was fantastic. And nonetheless, because it also allowed us to pass on a saving back to the customer. And that's a little trick that we actually learned from AWS, which is by being able to go out to a customer and have like a consumptive model and then show best practice for how you actually go and deploy this stuff effectively and efficiently, yes, you save your customer money and you demonstrate a way that they can get more value, but it also increases the footprint of other services that they use with you. And so we've taken a little leaf out of your book there.
Yeah, excellent. So when we think about product management and the world of software today, We hear a lot of feedback from customers who are who want to buy SaaS, and a lot of my software companies that we work with actually trying to develop SaaS. So, for a business that's maybe starting on the journey towards software as a service, what advice would you give them?
I think the world has changed so much in this past couple of years, and you've got to think about what is the buying process going to look like for that end customer? What is the demand that you're solving for? Where does this fit in the portfolio of services that they already have? And I think for a long time, SaaS played a role of being a number of kind of wedge products that existed between, you know, major systems that would hold, say, sales data or customer data, or on the personnel side, HR data. And you'd find there'd be lots of little opportunities to create applications that would sit in between. I think as we're starting to see that world shift, and as we're starting to see a more natural integration of data between these services, that's kind of limited what that footprint looks like. And so as organizations are looking to make that shift and they're looking to change the way that they enable their customers to buy, they've really got to think about, what is this deployment going to look like? How does it fit into the ecosystem that I'm already in? And ultimately, who are the key decision makers that are going to be making this purchase? Because that's actually as important as the deployment model itself.
Yeah, definitely. So we have a lot of conversations with our customers around the business aspects of software as a service and pricing and training Salesforce, paying Salesforces, all different elements as well as the technical ones. So as we wrap up this, I'd just like to get your views on what next for Trader.io in terms of your data strategy and where you see the company going over the next few years.
Yeah, I alluded to it a little bit at the start of our conversation, which is for us, traditional iPaaS is dying. And iPaaS has got to change, right? We can't go and look to buy something that was built, you know, 20, 30 years ago, that was deploying in a fragmented code base with an inelastic architecture. One of the benefits that we've had from working with AWS for so long is our software is lightning quick. And in a world that is moving as fast as it is today, the speed at which your automations can be deployed, the speed at which you want to get that real-time information back is absolutely critical in making these changes. And as we look ahead, you know, it's very clear that the world is shifting toward this AI-enabled enterprise. We're actually coining it the autonomous enterprise, which is a world where AI agents play a much more important role in proactively and reactively supporting you and your organization as you improve your go-to-market operation. And so all of our efforts and our investments and our focus and our data strategy is aligned around how can we harness this amazing technology to our customers, because it's evident to us that this is the path the world's going in and we can be right at the forefront of that.
Excellent. Very exciting future. So, I'd want to thank you, Rich, and thank you, Alin, for taking the time today. Also, thank you for your years of building on AWS and to help us both serve our joint customers. And really exciting future ahead, especially with GenAI and the AI-enabled features that you'll have. So thank you all for coming and watching our session today. And for any information, more information on Trey.io and to follow your journey, how do they get in touch?
Yeah, please look us up, Trey.io. We're on all the socials, as you can imagine. So look forward to seeing you there.
Excellent. Thank you.